Welcome to Hope Channel Western Mindanao Conference Lesson Review English Version. My warmest welcome to our Hope Radio listeners over the XBH Tangub City. Of course, I'd like to welcome all our Sabbath School members and teachers all throughout Western Mindanao Conference, South Philippines, the Visayas in Luzon, and of course, the Global Church who are watching, especially my friends in other countries. Thank you. It is my prayer that our experience with the Sabbath keeping would change us profoundly, and we will never be the same again. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, just before we start our discussions on our lesson, we pray for the Holy Spirit. He may change us. He may equip us with wisdom and understanding. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're now in lesson 12, second to the last of the quarter study on the Adventist education, December 12 to 8, entitled Sabbath, Experiencing and Living the Character of God. Our memory verse is Mark 2:27 and 28. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath. The two variables taken this text is the word Sabbath and the word man. Man is the recipient of the blessings of the Sabbath. And the model of keeping the Sabbath are not the Jews, not any other person on earth, not any organization or church, but the model of keeping the Sabbath is the Lord of the Sabbath, Jesus Christ. The word experience is simply means what we do. Anything that we do, that is experience. But I'd like to share with you a more profound definition of the word experience that captures or illustrates the concept that we are studying this week. Experience, according to Romano 1998, page 197, as cited by Wolf Michael Roth and Alfredo Jornet in the book Towards a Theory of Experience. They said, experience, in its fundamental sense, is that which, by putting us in play ourselves. So the players are ourselves. Experience modifies us profoundly in a way that after having crossed, traverse it, we will never be the same again. This is the tenet, the major concept of our lesson study this week. Our experience with God during this holy Sabbath day is intended to change us, and that we will never be the same again. We will keep on growing just like Jesus Christ, that our character may fully resemble the character of Jesus Christ. Beautiful. I also would like to share with you the theory on experience by John Dewey. And we will explain our lesson this week in the light of this theory, which serves as the framework of our study this week. According to the theory of experience by John Dewey, he defines education as the continuous reconstruction of experience. When we experience something, we act upon it. We do something with it. Then we suffer or undergo the consequences. We do something to the thing, and then it does something to us in return. There is an intricate relationship between experience and learning, as Dewey points out. To learn from experience is to make a backward and forward connection between what we do to things and what we enjoy or suffer from things in consequence. We will give examples to this concept using the lesson study suggestion or suggested text or narrative in order for us to fully understand. But in short, it's just like this. Experience is doing something to a person, to an object, to an animal, to anything. And this act that we do, whether it is matter, object, animals, or people, or God, they also respond to us. And that is the theory of experience. The responses of the things, people, or object, or animals to our act is possibly negative or it's possibly positive. That's the concept or the theory of experience. We will give more examples using biblical texts provided for us this week. This is the graphical presentation of the theory of experience by Dewey, and this was uploaded by Daniel Krutka. Thank you, Daniel. And I got this from Google Image. According to this, you see the arrow there, past experiences going to the future experiences. Connecting this in the class, the students experience interactions with the external conditions and the internal conditions, the thoughts, the mental processes. So the major concept here that defines the quality spiritual experience is interaction. Not all experiences are educative. Only the experiences in which the student or the person has interactions with the matter, with the animal, or with the human beings, or with any other things under the study. So let's look at the lesson in a nutshell. You notice there a circle, and inside the circle is God-centered education. What we're studying this week actually is an education centered on God, because God is the source of knowledge. He is the source of all information. He knows everything, and He has a special schedule for giving us all this information, and that is the seventh day Sabbath. Regular weekly schedule of God to educate His people, to sanctify His people. So this is a God-centered education. And this week, we're studying the Sabbath experience of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. We also studied this week the Sabbath experience of Israel during the 40 years in the wilderness with the experience of manna all throughout the 40 years of wandering. We will also study and review Sabbath experiences of the apostles with the community, and also Sabbath experiences of the woman with disability. What do they tell us about their knowledge, their learning, and their experience on Sabbath day? And also the Sabbath experience of the disciples in the grain field. And of course, our Sabbath experience. So that's all the topics we will be discussing all throughout this week. Sunday, December 13, time to be astonished. The major narrative here is taken from chapters 1 and 2 of the book of Genesis, the creation account, the creation of planet Earth, and the focus is on the human being. Adam and Eve being new on planet Earth, being new to themselves, being new to the God who created them. Our study guide is telling us that Adam and Eve had so many things to study. One of them, of course, is the God who created them, the God who created the beautiful surroundings they had, and of course, they have to study themselves, who they are, their anatomy, their physiology, and their relationship with one another. These are big concepts. These are big topics to discuss, to study, to know. And they also have to study their environment. So many things in the environment, like the animals, relationship, how they would care the environment, how they would interact with the animals. Of course, the relationship with God is an exhaustible study. Man can never exhaust the concept of God. In fact, all throughout eternity, we will be studying about God. Our lesson study guide is telling us that these subject matters selectively mentioned in the study guide are still relevant today. There is nothing in the subject that they studied in the garden that is irrelevant today. No. All of them, including what I have projected there, are still relevant subjects to be studied by any human beings in this world. A good example of that was the experience of Adam in Genesis chapter 2 verse 23, where this is an illustration of his astonishment, of his great excitement to learn God and his fellow human beings. He explored his environments, he named the animals, and Adam discovered that animals were paired by twos. They have partners, and he learned that he was alone. No one was like him. And so, according to the record, God put him to sleep, took one of his rib bones, and created Eve. When Eve was presented to Adam, he was astonished, and this is what he said: "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." The quality of experience involves the interaction between the subject and the environment. So the learning experience of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden before the fall was of the highest quality. Why? Because there was interaction. Adam interacted with Eve, and he interacted with God. He was so proud, he was so delighted to see fellow human beings. And I just imagine that Eve was thrilled when she was touched by Adam. When Adam tried to examine her bodies from head to foot, he was so happy to see human beings like him. So that was the thrill, that was the excitement of learning in the Garden of Eden. The lesson here, I am astonished with so many things to learn on Sabbath day. These subjects will never be obsolete. They are all relevant today, and we need to study all of them in order for us to appreciate the character of God and live the character of God. Monday, December 14, time for rediscovery. The biblical passage provided for us here refers to the experience of God's people, the Israelites, in the wilderness for 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. When they arrived in the wilderness from Egypt, the Lord has provided them teaching materials, experience, environment for them to rediscover, relearn who God is, their relationship to God, and God's relationship to them, and God's purpose for them as a whole nation. The most important phenomenological experience of God's people for them to learn God and their identity was the experience of manna. There was nobody, there was no store to provide them food. It was God who provided them daily food. And I illustrate it this way. The God-centered education in the wilderness culminated weekly on the Sabbath day. On the first day of the week, the Lord has provided them food, good only for the day. Day one, there was manna. Day two, we call Monday, God has provided them manna, good only for that day. And on day three, we call it Tuesday, God has provided them food, good enough for that day. Day four, we call it Wednesday, God has provided them manna, good enough for that day. And on day five, we call it Thursday, God has provided them manna, good only for that day. This daily provision was a miracle, but on sixth day, another miracle was performed by God, because on the sixth day, God has provided them good for 2 days. The pieces of manna that was provided for them on the sixth day was doubled. Why? It was reserved for the following day, which was the seventh day Sabbath. And on the seventh day, another miracle was performed by God. There was no manna on the seventh day. Why? To teach them that seventh-day Sabbath was holy. Please take note that they have forgotten the Sabbath, the essence of keeping the Sabbath, because they have been slaves for hundreds of years in Egypt. And this is God's opportunity to teach them, to educate them about the principles of the law, the principles of the Sabbath, that this is a scheduled time of God to sanctify their people. I'd like to read Exodus 16, 17 to 20. Take note of the interactions of the people of God during this weekly cycle in relation to the provision of God for their food. On the seventh day, some of the people went out to gather manna, but they found none. That is a good experience. See, the Lord has given you the Sabbath. Therefore, on the sixth day, He gives you bread for 2 days. So the people rested on the seventh day. So here the phenomenological learning of the people of God in the wilderness for 40 years. That was a daily experience. That was the daily miracle performed by God to teach them the holiness of God, to teach them that they need to be holy too, and that can only be done by His grace. So here, what do you think was the discovery of the people of God in the wilderness through manna on Sabbath day? They discovered, they learned when they went out and no manna was there. They discovered that they are highly, completely dependent upon God for the power of God, for the care of God, and for the love of God. Without God, they would never exist. They would never survive in the wilderness. That was what they rediscovered, that they are totally, completely dependent upon God. So the lesson is, I am completely dependent on God. That was based on the experience of the people of God. When they rediscovered who they were, who God is, and what is God's purpose for them, they learned it on the seventh day Sabbath when there was no manna. Tuesday, December 15, time for learning priorities. What are these priorities being discussed in our study guide? The context of this study is on how to keep the Sabbath. And I'd like to read Isaiah 58:13-14. The concept is taken in this chapter. If you turn back your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, or seeking your own pleasure, or talking idly, then you shall take delight in the Lord. Our lesson study guide is teaching us to prioritize activities, mental activities, physical activities which belong to God, and activities which belong to ourselves. In this topic, in this study, we are advised to prioritize the activities which the Lord has outlined in keeping the Sabbath day holy. It's a great temptation to keep the Sabbath day by our own way. So there are phrases here that we need to identify based on Isaiah 58:13-14. We should set aside our own pleasure. Our own pleasure on Sabbath day has no place. It should be discarded. What are these pleasures? Maybe watching television for other purposes, for pleasure purposes. Internet, Facebook, for personal pleasure. We should discard it. Not a priority on the holy day. Not doing your own way. God has His own prescribed way of keeping the Sabbath. No idle words should be spoken on this holy day. We hope we observe this according to this text. And we should focus on this day primarily on worship and secondarily on community service. Community service outside of the church are still expressions of worship. And this is the component of Jesus' way of keeping the Sabbath. Went into the synagogue according to his custom to read and to listen God's word there, but he went out of the temple and served the community, doing good to the people, healing them, visiting the sick, feeding the hungry, giving a glass of water, visiting the prisoners, in all these things related to community services, according to the teaching of Jesus, is in harmony with the principles of the law. And these are our priorities. And making the Sabbath holy is a day, is a time set aside, separate for the purpose of serving God. So it is exclusively God's time, God's day, and His people should also be separated or be set aside or the word holy. And we delight with it. It should be honorable before God. These are the priorities, and these are actually the characters of God that we live with it. It should be part of our system. We do it automatically because it has been embedded in us by the Holy Spirit. These are our priorities. So the lesson here is, I delight to live God's priorities. Wednesday, December 16, time for finding balance. What is these things that we should find balance? The concept here is based on the experience of Jesus Christ with the religious leaders or teachers during his time. In fairness to the Pharisees and other groups there who were teaching God's people about his law, they were faithful in teaching God's law, God's commandments. But there was a problem with their method of teaching. Why? They have provided so many rules and regulations on how to keep the Sabbath, on how to keep God's law. These rules and regulations are written in two books, Mishnah and Talmud. So many details, in a way that these details on how to keep the law have destroyed the essence of the law. They have destroyed the spirit of the law, such that the commandment of God was of no effect. So, like their culture, the rules, the traditions, So many of them have destroyed the spirit of the law, which are actually the character of God. This should have been lived by the people. This should have been developed. But because of these regulations, God objected the practice of teaching the people the way these religious leaders taught the people. A good example to that found in Luke 13:12, an encounter of Jesus with a woman. And Jesus said when he healed the woman, he said, "Woman, you are freed from your disability." Jesus was condemned by the religious leaders when he healed this woman. And Jesus said, "Because of your culture, of your rules, of your traditions, you make void the law of God." Because there was no more mercy, there was no more love because of the regulation. Jesus was not against regulation. We need them, but not too much, not rigid. It should not destroy the spirit of the law. Another example is Matthew 12, verse 1. His disciples were hungry, and they began to pluck heads of grain and to eat. Again, Jesus was condemned by these religious leaders because of the rules, the regulations so rigid that it has lost the essence, the principles of the law, which is love, which is mercy, which is forgiveness, which is grace. These are the character of God that we need to live. That is the title of our study, Living the Character of God. How can they live this character of love, justice, mercy, forgiveness, and grace when they were all choked by the rules and regulations? Ellen G. White has summed up the concept of the teaching of Jesus on this particular topic with this statement, and let me read and share it with you. Ellen White said in Child Guidance 323, she said, "In the school as well as in the home, there should be wise discipline. The teacher must make rules to guide the conduct of his pupils. These rules should be few and well considered." I'll repeat that. Rules are important, but should be very few and well considered. Unlike the religious leaders at the time of Christ, so many of these rules and regulations that it distorted the spirit of the law. And once made, they should be enforced. Every principle involved in them should be so placed before the student that he will be convinced of its justice. So you know what is very clear? There should only be few rules, but it must be enforced. But the principles behind these rules and regulations must be explained before the people, before the students, so that they will be convinced of the justice of the rules. Beautiful. So the lesson here is, I balance rules and regulations with the character of God. Last Thursday, December 17, a time for community. Beautiful. Keeping the Sabbath should not be confined only to the church building. God's people who have been sanctified by His word should get out to the community and serve the people. This is the best form of keeping the Sabbath, time for community. And we have records from Acts chapter 13, verse 44, Acts 16, verse 13, and Acts 17, 1-5. Let me read the first text. The apostles visited a place, and they entered into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and they preached there. And the people, when they listened to the preaching of Paul, which was actually a testimony based from history, he recounted the history of God's people from Abraham in Canaan to Egypt during the slavery until they reached Canaan and the people of God. And then he ended with Jesus Christ as the fulfillment of the Messiah. When they heard this history from the Bible in their testimonial message, the people requested that this message be preached on them on the next Sabbath day. And when the next Sabbath day came, verse 44, almost the whole city gathered to hear God's word. So the place of learning was the synagogue, time Sabbath day, by the apostle. Okay? Another text is Acts 16, verse 13. "And on the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate to the riverside." You see, the apostles did not only teach the people in the temple, in the synagogue, but at the riverside community. They went outside the gate to the riverside. "We sat down and spoke to the women." They taught the people. Beautiful picture. This is the ideal way of keeping the Sabbath holy. So I'm encouraging our church members, get out of the church building on Sabbath afternoon. The executive committee of Western Mindanao Conference had already approved that we should get out. But you see, we had to balance also because we have no more time for our young people to be cultured, to be nurtured on Sabbath day. That is the only time. And this needs balancing. How much time should we spend in the church building with young people and how much time should be spent outside of the church to serve the community? That's a challenge. And then the last text there is Acts 17:1-5. And Paul went in on three Sabbath days. He reasoned from the scriptures, explaining and proving that this is the Christ, the Savior of men. So these are the key words there for the time for community. Paul was reasoning using the Bible. He shared his testimony. He used the synagogue. He used the river. He used other places. And he actually used the Bible, the history, explaining and reasoning. These are activities, mental as well as physical, to teach the people in the church and outside of the church. The quality of experience involves interaction between the subject and the environment. And we see here that this theory on experience is of the highest quality. Why? There was explanation, there was reasoning, there was debate there was interactions with the preacher and the listeners. So it was a quality experience of God's people in the Bible, both in the Old and in New Testament. The lesson here is, I spend the Sabbath in community service. We'll get back to this in the next slide. So I put them all together, all these lessons. Number one, I am impressed with so many things to learn. My response to the first statement is 5. I strongly agree that all these subjects Adam and Eve learned in the garden are still relevant today. Learning ourselves, learning other people, interpersonal, intrapersonal, learning animals, learning objects under the sun, they are all relevant. Speaking, demonstrating, revealing the nature, the character of God in all these created things. I strongly agree with that. So number 5, I'm completely dependent on God. I also strongly agree with that. What shall I do if there is no God? We will never survive. The breath, the air, the oxygen that goes in and out of our nostrils is the work of God. If there is no God, there is no life. So I am completely dependent of God. I discovered it and keep on rediscovering this concept. And there are many other concepts there. Number 3, I delight to live God's priorities. I strongly agree that when I keep the Sabbath, it's all the will of God, the descriptions on how to keep the Sabbath, that it is a delight. It's a delight on the part of the keeper of the Sabbath when he worships God at the same time he serves the community. Number 4, I balance rules, regulations with God's character. My response to this is agree, because I'm not perfect in balancing rules and regulations in my home as well as in the church. But I try my best to balance. A regulation should be few, and this regulation should reflect the character of God. Number 5, I spend the Sabbath for community service. My response to this is 3. Low. Why? Because in my present situation, context right now, every day I spend my day in the community. Our evangelism is every day and every night. Nurture. On Sabbath day, that's the time for young people, and we are trying our best, and this is the challenge, to get out of the church building on Sabbath day for community service. By the way, we also spend community services not on Saturday, during the weekdays, but it would be best if we spend maybe 30 minutes or an hour for community service, not on other day, but on Sabbath day, part of our worship on the holy day. So I added up 4.4. My Sabbath experience or living the character of God is 4.4. And that is highly intentional. However, there is still room for me to improve, to grow. And that is on balancing rules and regulations with the character of God. And of course, spending Sabbath for community service. This lesson is a challenge for me. I need to show it to the people that on Sabbath day, I get out to do community service. I do community service in fairness, but not on Sabbath day. But this lesson is teaching us we need to spend maybe 30 30 minutes or an hour to go to the community and serve. This has been acted by the Executive Committee of Western Mineral Conference, and we hope we can follow it little by little. Okay? So let me close our study tonight by reading Ellen White's Desire of Ages, page 283. In order to keep the Sabbath holy, men must themselves be holy. Through faith, they must become partakers of the righteousness of Christ. When the command was given to Israel, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The Lord said also to them, ye shall be holy men unto me. Only thus could the Sabbath distinguish Israel as the worshippers of God. Loving God, thank you that you have given us the special gift of time, one day every week, to sanctify us, to make us holy, so that we can glorify you by worshiping you in the church and by worshiping you outside of the church building, serving the community. Give us the grace that we can live this character of Jesus Christ. Help us that through the Sabbath, we can be truly loving like our Master Jesus Christ. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Lift up the trumpet and loud.